In this lecture, we're going to cover anticoagulants and antiplatelet agents. So let's get right into it. Anticoagulants and antiplatelet agents are used to treat thrombotic disorders, or unwanted clot inside a blood vessel which can lead to heart attack or stroke. But before we discuss their mechanism of action, let's quickly review the clotting process. So in the absence of injury, the endothelial cells that make up the inner surface of blood vessels release chemical mediators such as nitric oxide and prostacyclin. Now, nitric oxide's job is to dilate blood vessels, while prostacyclin's job is to bind to receptors located on platelets. This binding triggers certain reactions which ultimately prevent platelet activation and aggregation. Now, what happens when there is a damaged blood vessel? Let's say due to skin cut. Well, suddenly we have less nitric oxide and prostacyclin around, so blood vessels become constricted and platelets become activated. But first thing first, with the help of von Willebrand factors, platelets adhere to exposed collagen, which in turn causes them to change shape. Next, these activated differently shaped platelets begin to release granules containing chemical mediators such as ADP, thrombin, thromboxane A2, serotonin, and platelet activating factor, which attract and activate even more platelets that come to the site of injury. Now, the final step involves activation of the glycoprotein 2B3A receptors, which bind circulating fibrinogen. The fibrinogen simultaneously binds to these receptors on two separate platelets, thus cross-linking platelets to form aggregates. Now, there are several drugs that can disrupt this platelet plaque formation. Collectively, we call them platelet aggregation inhibitors, or simply antiplatelet drugs. One of the most widely known drugs that belongs to this class is aspirin. In order to understand how aspirin works, let's take a closer look at the inside of a platelet. So when platelet becomes activated, arachidonic acid is released from the membrane phospholipids. Then it gets converted to prostaglandin H2 by cyclooxygenase 1 enzyme, also known as COX-1. Finally, prostaglandin H2 is further metabolized to thromboxane A2, which is released from the platelet to stimulate activation of new platelets as well as promote their aggregation. So what aspirin does is it irreversibly inactivates COX-1 enzyme, thus effectively disrupting clot formation. Next, we have platelet aggregation inhibitors that work by blocking the action of ADP receptor, specifically P2Y12 subtype. Drugs that belong to this group include clopidogrel, ticagrelor, ticlopidine, and prasugrel. As I mentioned before, activated platelets release chemical mediators. One of them is ADP, which binds to PTY12 receptor, leading to activation of the glycoprotein 2B3A receptors, which are required for fibrin-mediated platelet cross-linking. So by blocking PTY12 ADP receptors, these drugs effectively inhibit platelet aggregation and thus clot formation. Next, we have glycoprotein 2B3A receptor blockers, namely apixaban, eptifibatide, and tirofiban. These agents simply inhibit platelet aggregation by binding to the glycoprotein 2B3A receptors on platelets, thus preventing fibrinogen from binding to platelets and making them unable to cross-link. Unlike the other drugs that we discussed so far, glycoprotein 2B3A inhibitors are administered only intravenously. Now, the last group of antiplatelet drugs that I wanted to briefly discuss are phosphodiesterase inhibitors, namely dipyridamole and cilostazol. These two agents inhibit enzyme called phosphodiesterase that is responsible for breaking down cyclic AMP to AMP. So by blocking this enzyme, dipyridamole and cilostazol increase intracellular levels of cyclic AMP, which in turn leads to decreasing intracellular calcium and ultimately inhibition of platelet activation. Furthermore, These agents inhibit phosphodiesterase in the vascular wall, as well as uptake of adenosine, which promotes vasodilation. For that reason, psilocybin in particular is often used to treat symptoms of peripheral artery disease, such as narrowing of vessels that supply blood to legs. When it comes to side effects, bleeding is a major risk associated with all antiplatelet drugs. Additionally, diperidamol and psilocybin, due to their vasodilating properties, can produce headaches. Now let's go back to our review of clot formation. So the aggregation of platelets acting like a plaque is usually not enough to secure the site of injury. In order to strengthen the platelet plaque, a clot must form. The formation of clot involves cascade of enzyme reactions that transform various clotting factors to their active forms, ultimately producing web-like fibrin mesh. Now there are two pathways involved with the clotting cascade. The intrinsic pathway, which is activated by damage directly to the blood vessel wall, and extrinsic pathway, which is activated by trauma to the vascular wall as well as surrounding tissue. So the intrinsic pathway starts with clotting factor 12, which is activated when blood comes into contact with the collagen in the damaged vascular wall. And here, A next to the Roman numeral stands for activated. This sets a series of reactions that leads to activation of factor 11, which then activates factor 9, which then activates factor 10. Activated factor 10 then converts prothrombin to thrombin. And finally, thrombin converts fibrinogen to fibrin, which forms mesh that strengthens the platelet plaque. Now, let's take a look at the extrinsic pathway. So, extrinsic pathway is triggered by tissue factor released from damaged cells outside the circulating blood. It starts with the activation of factor 7, which then activates factor 10. So at this point, the intrinsic and extrinsic pathway converge into common pathway, which again results in formation of fibrin clot. And as a side note here, keep in mind that this is just a simplified description of coagulation cascade and many details were intentionally omitted. So now let's switch gears and let's talk about anticoagulants. That is, drugs that work by disrupting this coagulation cascade. And let's begin by discussing one of the most widely recognized anticoagulants, that is, heparin and low molecular weight heparins, such as enoxaparin and dalteparin. Now, these agents bind to our natural anticoagulant circulating in blood called antithrombin 3. The primary function of antithrombin is to inactivate factor 10a and thrombin. So what heparin drugs do is they bind to antithrombin, and by doing so, they accelerate its activity. In case of heparin, its binding to antithrombin results in rapid inactivation of both factor 10a and thrombin. However, unlike heparin, low molecular weight heparins have very little effect on inactivation of thrombin, and instead they selectively accelerate inactivation of factor 10a. Another agent worth mentioning here that also selectively accelerate inactivation of factor 10a is fondaparinux. However, unlike low molecular weight heparins, fondaparinux doesn't bind to any other plasma proteins and has no direct effect on thrombin. When it comes to side effects, bleeding is a major risk. Fortunately, there is a reversal agent called protamine sulfate, which can be used to treat excessive bleeding caused by heparin drugs. Protamine sulfate simply works by binding to heparin or low molecular weight heparins to form stable inactive complex. Fondaparinux, on the other hand, doesn't have any specific antidote at this time. Another possible major side effect that is particularly associated with the use of heparin agents is heparin-induced thrombocytopenia, HIT for short. HIT is a disorder caused by immune system making antibodies to heparin when it's bound to platelet-derived protein called platelet factor 4. Once the antibodies bind to these heparin platelet factor 4 complexes, they begin to activate platelets which clump together, causing formation of unwanted clots and fall in platelet count. Now, let's move on to another group of anticoagulants, that is direct inhibitors of factor 10A. Agents that belong to this group are apixaban and rivaroxaban. The mechanism of action of these drugs is very simple. They both bind directly to the active site of factor 10A, thus preventing it from converting prothrombin to thrombin. The biggest advantage of these agents over the other anticoagulants that we discussed is that they are available in oral formulation. Unfortunately, bleeding is still a major risk and specific antidote is currently not available. Now, let's move on to the next group of anticoagulants, that is direct thrombin inhibitors. Now, depending on how they interact with the thrombin molecule, agents in this group can be subdivided into two classes. First, we have univalent direct thrombin inhibitors, which bind only to the active site. Examples of drugs that belong to this class are ergatroban and dabigatran. The second class are bivalent direct thrombin inhibitors, which bind to both the active site and the exocyte 1, that is fibrinogen binding site. This bivalent binding contributes to their high affinity and high specificity for thrombin. Examples of drugs that belong to this class are bivalirudin and desirudin. Now, one of the biggest advantages of direct thrombin inhibitors over indirect thrombin inhibitors such as heparin is that they don't bind to platelet factor 4, which makes them very useful in treatment of heparin-induced thrombocytopenia. However, just like with other anticoagulants, bleeding is a major risk and there is no specific antidote available at this time. Now, there is one more anticoagulant that I wanted to discuss, which is warfarin. Warfarin is one of the oldest anticoagulants that's still on the market, and it has its own unique mechanism of action. Now, in order to understand how warfarin works, it's important to first understand the role of vitamin K in the coagulation cascade. So, vitamin K is required for synthesis of factors 2, 7, 9, and 10. These coagulation factors are biologically inactive until they are carboxylated by vitamin K. This carboxylation reaction proceeds when we have reduced form of vitamin K available. In this reaction, reduced vitamin K is oxidized to the vitamin K epoxide in the presence of oxygen and carbon dioxide, yielding carboxylated, fully active clotting factors. In the last step of this reaction, oxidized vitamin K is recycled back to the reduced form by enzyme called vitamin K epoxide reductase. This is where warfarin comes into play, as it inhibits this enzyme and thus disrupts this vitamin K-dependent synthesis of biologically active clotting factors as well as some other regulatory factors. Now, one of the biggest disadvantages of warfarin is that it has a narrow therapeutic window and has been associated with many drug-drug and drug-food interactions. For these reasons, clinicians need to closely monitor patients on warfarin by using the International Normalized Ratio measurements, also known as INR, and adjust the dose when necessary to balance the risk of bleeding against the risk of clotting. Fortunately, in the event of bleeding, anticoagulant effects of warfarin can be overcome by administration of vitamin K. However, reversal can take up to 24 hours, therefore in the event of emergency, infusion of fresh frozen plasma might be necessary. Now, the last group of drugs that I wanted to discuss in this lecture are thrombolytics. While antiplatelets and anticoagulants prevent the clot from getting formed in the first place, thrombolytics act on the existing clot, causing it to dissolve. And the way they do this is by directly or indirectly activating circulating protein called plasminogen, which then turns into plasmin. Now, plasmin is an enzyme that breaks cross-links between fibrin molecules, thereby dissolving the clot. Examples of thrombolytics include alteplase, reteplase, and tenecteplase, which are produced by recombinant DNA technology to mimic our naturally occurring tissue plasminogen activator. Another example is an agent called urokinase, which is a naturally occurring thrombolytic produced from cultured human kidney cells. And lastly, we have an agent called streptokinase, which is derived from streptococcal bacteria. Now, one of the main differences between these agents is their selectivity for fibrin-bound plasminogen versus free-circulating plasminogen. So while tissue plasminogen activator such as alteplase is more clot-selective and acts to dissolve the fibrin in the thrombus, streptokinase and urokinase are less clot-selective and thus are more likely to cause internal bleeding into any organ system. These bleeding complications from thrombolytic therapy can be managed by administration of aminocaproic acid or tranexamic acid. These two agents can stop fibrinolysis by inhibiting binding of plasminogen to fibrin as well as conversion of plasminogen to plasmin. And with that, I wanted to thank you for watching. I hope you enjoyed this lecture, and as always, stay tuned for more.